Hello, Meoni here, and welcome back to another Tea Time with me, Meoni. And this might come as a bit of a surprise to a lot of you, since I've already done one of these videos this week, but I thought due to the current situations in the world, let's say, I think people need someone to talk to them a little more frequently and give you basically something sizable to listen to. And yeah, essentially this is as close to streaming as I can possibly get. Believe me, if I did have the ability to live stream, I would love to talk to you live and get your questions and answers sorted. But that's something we can consider for the comment section, and I'll answer it in another video next week. But I thought I'd do a second tea time because I do actually have things to talk about, which is always obviously a good part about doing something like a podcast size episode like this one. But at the same time, I thought that it would be nice to, you know, keep people interested if they're in self-isolation due to the current crisis in the world, and try and take some minds off of some issues. So let's talk about Final Fantasy XIV, the game we all love and, love to enjoy talking about as much as we do play it. So the recent thing is 5.21. So we talked about this previously in the other tea time. There was some really interesting responses of what people thought about the restoration, but we've recently also seen a little bit more progression towards some actual goals. So we've had the first rankings completed for the Ishgard restoration for patch 5.2 cycle of this, and essentially the top 100 people get a title, and I think they do, and then the top 12 people get a different title. I'm not sure what those titles are yet. I do know somebody in my community who has one, so we'll be talking to them at a later date, no doubt, because I want to get sort of information from them of what they felt the Ishgard restoration was like for them, because obviously, they put more time into that than anything else in the game. So we have quite a bit to talk about in regards to that. So if you don't like the restoration, this might be not your cup of tea, but I'll try and spice it up and put some other stuff in this as well, not just the restoration. But let's talk about that first. So the rankings did come out, and some of the scores of people, which obviously I'm not going to show them on screen because that would be potentially bad for me. I can't really name and shame certain people, but it's very clear to me that some of the activity related to the Ishgard restoration on certain servers in the rankings, you can certainly see, especially on the gathering classes, that some of those numbers that they achieved were possibly not that doable. In fact, I think they were probably impossible without the use of third-party botting technology, essentially. Otherwise, people will have had literally no sleep and have been basically fishing or doing botany non-stop for the past week or so without sleep. It's been that competitive. If you look at the numbers, then you can sort of deduce what's been going on, especially if you consider some of my other friends who have been literally doing nothing than gathering themselves, and especially on the fishing side. And they're just about in the 100k mark, thereabouts, maybe a little bit more than that. But obviously some of the people are in the millions of points, which is frankly just bizarre to me. I know you can get certain procs and you can mooch certain fish to get better stuff, and it's all RNG at the end of the day. But you'd have to have some pretty crazy RNG and all of the time in the world with no sleep pattern at all to actually get this to work. Now, some people, obviously, it is worth mentioning, have worked very hard on this. I'm not saying I'm looking at the leaderboards and going, well, this person's definitely botting, this person's definitely botting. It just adds up, especially when on my own server, for example, if you see people in the restoration, in Diadem specifically, and, I've attempted to communicate with a couple of these individuals, and you don't get any reply. Now, that could be obviously them just focusing on the task at hand, but if I saw somebody message me on my character, at least after the fish that I was tugging, I would at least give them a reply. And some of the behavior of the botanists have been a little bit erratic, especially with how they mount, move directly upwards, and then strafe to their destination, go directly downwards, and then gather. Now, that's hard to actually pull off perfectly on that same route for hours and hours and hours. So I'm basically not saying that they're bots, but I'm kind of saying they kind of probably are, some of them. So obviously, it's going to reward people who put the most time into this, or the people who decide to use third-party tools to actually make it easier for themselves. So it's obvious at the end of the day, you know who you are, but I just hope that you're happy with yourselves and this ticks off a little box for you if you have decided to bot this. Me personally, I'm not interested in rankings. The only interest I had was the minions. I've got them. I will eventually kind of work towards the mount for 500k on every class, but that just seems like such a pipe dream. I'm not sure I have the stomach to physically do it myself. I know a lot of people on those leaderboards actually have 500k in fishing, in botany, in mining. Then they have 500k points already in weaver and alchemist and blacksmith. And I'm thinking to myself, how has this been possible? Do they know something that I do not? Or is it that they have literally not logged out? They've planned this all out and that they've just gone ham? Or are they using tools externally? And obviously we can't prove or disprove any of this, because there is no way of detecting this stuff apart from people reporting them and then obviously them, you know, giving feedback to Square Enix and fighting those cases on a case-by-case thing, which is not something we can talk about publicly anyway. I've not reported anybody. I didn't see the point in it. This isn't something that I would advise anyone to do. But if you do notice somebody that is actively botting, you should probably report them. Feature under and give, basically type in the box a little bit of information about what exactly they've been doing, the activity that you've seen, and hopefully the GMs can look into that, because we're not the police at the end of the day, but there are tools to allow us to get the people who do police the game to be involved in this. So it's been interesting. A friend of mine, like I say, who I want to talk to, is actually in the top 12 of another server, one of the lower population servers, where it does seem to be that the people on those rankings have much like lower numbers, and they pale in comparison to the bigger servers like Ragnarok or indeed Cerberus, where the scores are absolutely astronomical in comparison. I think it was like the 50k here and there, and in comparison to the people who have got like a million points in fishing or more, which is quite bizarre on our own server to see. But yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what they think about this botting as well. So this might be like an interview situation, how they feel about their work being undermined by people actively not doing anything and essentially allowing tools to do the work for them. This is kind of like the first time in gathering and crafting, at least, where we've had some rewards for actually spending more time doing it. I know there's RNG involved in it, but this is the first time we've had proper rankings for that. So it's interesting to see what that side of a community thinks. From the most sort of information I've seen, a lot of people are very sort of irritated, let's say, by the idea of people botting. But at the same time, the rewards are titles at the moment, so people aren't too bothered about that. Now, it would be a completely different story if you were awarded a mount or a minion for getting in that top 12 or top 100. You can imagine the sort of lengths people would go to actually get them, which is why I firmly believe that people are only really botting on the higher population servers if you compare the numbers. But I could be completely wrong. I have no idea. But there's been a lot of speculation in the community and a lot of raised fists, let's say, and angered voices, basically saying, why should I bother taking part in this if people aren't going to even try and do it themselves? Which is a fair point, but there's no way of controlling those people. You can only do what you do yourself, which is just the nature of anything in this game. People bot, people bot the crafting, they bot the gathering, they bot PvP, they win trade in PvP, which is just as annoying. If you ask me, at least anyway. So those top spaces, you're basically win trading them. You can actually pay for the top 100 spaces in PvP if you know the right people who have basically people queue at the right time to try and fix the matches. There's sort of things that you can do to mitigate that, but at the end of the day, if you have enough money on the table, then you can pretty much buy anything you want in the game. People are obviously buying runs of the Coil of Ultimate Bahamut and Ultimate Alexander, which is blatantly obvious if you look at those people, their gear, and then suddenly they have that weapon and they have one class at 80 with terrible gear, then it's kind of obvious there as well. But people will make the most out of any way of exploiting tools or services that, you know, are not condoned by Square Enix. In any game, it just seems to be that no matter where you look, people are actively attempting to bot basically all of it. You can buy runs for the Morbole mount, for example, from the Savage Modes of Alexander. Why you would want to do that for your Blue Mage just for a mount, I have no idea. It seems like one of the things that I would love to do with a group of people, but people aren't interested when I ask them. Or if I do ask them, you know, they haven't got all of the skills and abilities required. They haven't unlocked res. They haven't finished a mass carnival, so there's blockers there. So at the same time, you can kind of understand why some people would pay for that. But at the same time, you're taking any enjoyment away from the game. But then the flip side to that, the argument that will no doubt be in the comment section of this video will be people saying, well, I work, you know, 50 hours a week or more, 80 hours a week or more. I don't have time to organize these groups. I simply pay for those runs. Now, I'm not saying you're a bad person in any way, shape or form. And if you do that, that's totally at your discretion. I just feel that the people who do have the most time and do have jobs that allow them to play more than other people, which I do know about, and I do know some of them who have purchased runs of things or do bot the game in certain content, I don't really believe why they do that other than just to shove it in the face of their friends. They always have to have the latest thing by any means. If they can throw cash at it, they will. If they can bot it, they will. You name it, people will do that. Those people exist, and some of them are closer friends than you know, you'd think. To me personally, I'm not going to mention any names because it doesn't make sense to do that for me, and that's not the sort of person I am. I completely respect them and their choices, but at the same time, you have to question, in reality, what you get out of that at the end of the day. Past your friends being impressed, do you gain anything, or is it quite a hollow feeling? I don't know. I've never done that personally myself in this game. I have actually purchased a run of something in World of Warcraft back in, where was it? I think it was when my guild finished. Like we basically couldn't do the content. It wasn't Mists of Pandaria. I really can't remember. There was something. Actually, it might have been Mists of Pandaria. I think I purchased a run from a guild with in-game currency. I purchased a run of, what's the name of that instance? The one in Twilight Highlands. That one there on the hardest difficulty, just simply to get the stuff done that we couldn't finish. But just because I wanted the ahead of the curve achievement at the time. Yes, I know it's dumb, and that is essentially RMT, although it's not real money. It was just, you know, gold that I had saved up from selling stuff because I was crafting. Back when crafting in World of Warcraft used to get you lots of gold. And I still feel bad about that today. I don't necessarily understand why people can take that experience, that hollow feeling that I received when I did that in that game, and then do that repeatedly. It must feel really unusual to you, but hats off to you if you do that, if that's what you want to do, if that's what gets you through the day, the week, or whatever, or through the content, then that's totally for you. But personally, I just don't understand the feeling. It's not something I've ever really understood. And it's something that I would be filled with regret with, personally. But yeah, I'm not putting shade on anyone or anything like that. Some of the people who do this stuff, by the way, are the most fantastic people on the planet. They're the nicest people you will ever talk to. And a lot of them, like I say, just do simply purchase runs because they work their ass off for the government or, you know, who be it. And at the end of the day, they don't have time to sort of organize these same runs. But, you know, it is what it is. But when we come to stuff like the Ishgard Restoration, you have to question things, especially just for a title. That it would be a lot worse, like I say, if there was a mount or minion, which is presumably why there isn't such a reward at this point. If they do add a mount or something like that to the reward scheme for future rankings for the Restoration, then I think all hell shall break loose. And we'll have to see what kind of fireworks are lit up then, because I'm sure the forums will be lit up rather with the anger of the consumer base. So let's move on then from that. I did say we're not going to be talking about this for too long, but essentially, just to finish off the Ishgard restoration, I have really been enjoying the progression of the actual places. So if you're there, you get to take part in a fate. I think it's a lot better than the previous iteration of the restoration. There's a lot more going on. We've recently finished the area with the statues, and we've built a little bridge towards Saint somebody's dais. I think it's Saint Roel's dais, and we're working on that currently. It's fantastic when you see how many people on different servers are progressing. On Ragnarok, we're currently on, I believe, the second stage of St. Roel's Dias. But if you look at the Japanese data center, for example, you've got servers like Chocobo and I think it's Tonbury, which are like on the eighth stage, which is absolutely mind-blowing. But you have to consider and respect the amount of time that people are actually putting into this. And they seem to be a lot more dedicated than the rest of the world, for sure. So, yeah. Everything is so meticulously planned out, I would imagine, on those servers. And people have a lot of interest in them. You also have to put, you know, the current crisis in the world into perspective as well. There's a lot more people at home across the world that are going to be doing pretty much nothing other than crafting, right? They're in isolation. They have nothing else to do. So you've got that to sort of factor in. And that could even actually factor into our previous discussion earlier about the potential for how many of those are actually bots or not, because I didn't at the time a few minutes ago admittedly think to myself, well, actually some people probably aren't getting a decent night's sleep. So I do apologize, but I wasn't inferring that anybody specifically was a bot. And if you have worked your ass off on this restoration, then massive congratulations to you and anyone who does that. But yeah, let's move on from that. So the next thing to talk about on my list then is Animal Crossing. I wanted to briefly talk about this. All of the new releases sort of pale in comparison to the hype that this game has been sort of gaining. Everybody I know in the 14 community and externally from it, or at least my close friends, seem to be pretty hyped for this game. I personally picked it up yesterday. I had the digital version, so I played from midnight today, essentially, but it felt like yesterday to me. I've slept since then. And it is really, really good. It reminds me of the old Animal Crossing games. If you've ever played them, you're essentially a human character in a world filled with animal-human hybrids, or at least bipedal animals that talk to you. And that's a really weird way of describing the game. But essentially, you get to harvest things, you can go fishing, you can build things, you can work towards goals, you can design custom designs and make little clothes for your character to wear. Yes, obviously this is a game for all ages, and it does look a little bit unusual maybe to some of you, the same sort of people who think it's unusual for a male to play female characters in games. Some of you might be questioning, well, he's 31 years old, why is he playing a kid's game? Well, I'll tell you, because you're never too old for gaming. And if you look at the side of a box and see 3 years plus, and you respect that as, oh, well, you have to be three to play it, then you are the most sheltered person on the planet. I'm sorry, I have to say that, because I firmly believe that age is a restriction that doesn't really make sense. Now, obviously, there are things such as laws that have ages associated with them. Those I do not disagree with. However, when it comes to playing media, etc., you know, a good bit of parental guidance in certain areas, and obviously some things that are maybe X-rated shouldn't be given to kids and stuff like that. But games like Animal Crossing, you shouldn't feel bad if you're in your 30s, your 40s, your 50s, or your 60s playing that game. You know, there was a grandma, I can't remember her name, what was it, is it Maud? I can't remember. She was a Twitch streamer, well, I believe she still is, I don't know why I said was, and I believe she put 6,000 hours or something into Animal Crossing on the DS and live stream it. It's fantastic. It's fantastic that she had, honestly, the balls to do that, knowing the sort of response that she would get for doing it. But at the same time, you have to not care at the end of the day. You have to just go, I'm playing a game. I'm enjoying it. I want to share my experiences. And if people are going to knock you for that, then they're no friends of yours at the end of the day. If you want to play Gears of War or whatever, as well as Animal Crossing or Doom, which just recently released, which looks awesome, by the way, I want to pick that up myself, Doom Eternal. Why is it a problem? It's the same thing when we go to the console war. Oh, I like PlayStation more than Xbox. I hate Xbox players. Have you ever listened to yourself for just 5 minutes and realized they're playing games? We all play games. Why are we so hostile to each other? Play what the bloody hell you want to. At the end of the day, you're still enjoying the same stuff. Why can't you have that connection point? Why can't you just move on? But yeah, there's a lot of barriers in life. But age certainly shouldn't be them, and neither should be gender. But, you know, it's another topic that people get really salty about when I talk about it. But, you know, more recently, I have been more annoyed than anything seeing people say, ha ha ha, he plays a female character in this game. Why is he playing as this little prissy cat girl when he could be playing as a butch rogadin or a male human? Well, there's your answer. It's a fantasy role-playing game, okay? If I wanted to play as a human male, right, wouldn't that be kind of the same as if I was just getting up in the morning? Wouldn't I have issues with playing the same? Like, my creativity isn't as stunted as some of you might be in that sort of situation. If you're like, oh, I have a problem with him because of him playing a female character, it's really a problem reflected from you. Your insecurities are being reflected in your words. Do you not understand that? Every time somebody says, oh, ha ha, he plays a female character, he's a male, what a, you know, insert slanderous word here, or homosexual phrases. No, I'm a straight male with a girlfriend that equally enjoys the fact that I play what I want to. You know, I'm not bound by the same restrictions that for some reason you're enforcing. I don't care how you've been brought up, but this is something that maybe you should be discreet about. Because we live in a day and an age now, I mean, even further now, where people can do what they want. It's a fantasy game. It's a game. It's not like I'm going out there doing, well, there wouldn't be any problem if I did go and wear a dress, would there? You know, at the end of the day, some people might have problems with that. Me personally, I don't have the interest in doing that. I respect people who do that. Just to reiterate that, I have not a single homophobic sort of bone in, or any sort of phobic bone in my body. In fact, the only phobia I have is I'm kind of worried about the people more than afraid of them that think that there's something wrong by doing something different than they do themselves. It's weird, man. Like, I have to admit, sort of toot my own horn a bit, I am a creative at the end of the day. I love creative people. I love expressionist people. What I don't love are people that are stuck in a little box shouting slanders or, you know, racial insults and stuff from across the yard. It's not pretty in any way, shape, or form. It's not clever, you know. You have the IQ of a lemon at the end of the day if you're doing that sort of behavior. I know this is a bit of a tangent, but it annoys me. I'm sorry. But yeah, Animal Crossing is a great game, and you should play it if you like sort of RPGs, that sort of exploration stuff, a slower pace of life. You know, you can really just kick back, enjoy stuff, get distracted. It's a perfect game to be playing right now when life is just taking an absolute dump on a lot of people worldwide. There's a lot of people suffering out there. What better than a distraction like that? So those people who are saying, oh, you're playing Animal Crossing, wow, what a insert word here, go away. Basically, just go away. I'd say the F word to you, sir, but I need my rating so I don't get demonetized here. But go away. Go to some rock, hide under it, and don't come out again. Because at the end of the day, you're weird. You're the weird one, not us. Let us enjoy what we want to enjoy. I don't understand why people like that get enjoyment from seeing other people's misery. I'm going on a bit of a more of a tangent. We need to move on. Animal Crossing. Fantastic game. Really enjoying it so far. I want to do a first impressions video on that. I'm going to get some footage. I've got, obviously, my capture card. Expect that this weekend. I'll be doing videos at the weekend because I've been a bit low on the videos this week, but I've been preparing stuff for this weekend. So, yeah, we'll have Meoni videos at the weekend. It's not something I usually do, but, you know, the world's in a bit of an interesting situation, and I know a lot of you find a lot of just time passes easily when you're listening to somebody talk about something or watch somebody enjoying something that quite rightfully they should enjoy. So I will have a video on that for sure. I also want to do videos on the Trials of Mana demo. Yes, I'm quite excited about Trials of Mana. If you've known me long enough, then you'd know that Secret of Mana, Saiken Densetsu 2, is like my favorite game ever made. If there ever was a term to be placed on that, if I had to choose, it would be that game. I love that game, the original to death. I really enjoyed the re-release, the remake, rather. Excuse me. Got a bit of indigestion there. I really enjoyed what they did with the 3D sprites. The overly cartoony look put some people off. But honestly, people who play SNES games and then complain about a remake from them looking slightly cartoony doesn't have a screw right in the head. Because I know there were technical limitations, but there was a reason they were redesigned or re-released with that look and aesthetic. It's because that's what originally that character looked like. It's a sprite. That you can't make it super realistic. It doesn't work. A lot of the Final Fantasy VII mods and Final Fantasy VIII mods that you can get are visual overhauls of the characters. So you can make Squall look like this crazily detailed person, but it takes some of the charm away from it, right? That's my argument at the end of the day. None of those mods have been installed on my PC because I take one look at the preview window and I'm like, why would you do that? You know, an old game, not only are you gonna up the quality of the sprites, which would be fine, you're gonna change them and make them more human. They mess with the proportions of the body, for example. Yeah, it could work, but it's not honoring the original enough for me to be interested. There's a lot of us out there that just kind of want a visual upgrade but without changing anything specifically, and I think a lot of the modding community misses that. But when it comes to Trials of Mana, it looks exceptional. I've only, dabbled in it slightly. I wanted to keep my first impressions as an actual video of actual first impressions. I basically just tested it to see if it worked on my capture card, and then I turned it off. But from what little I did sort of press the button on, I was quite impressed. Now, obviously, that's an unusual thing. A few seconds of gameplay and I'm impressed. But I've been looking at trailers for that game forever. Yes, I have pre-ordered it. I'm a sucker for that. I've even pre-ordered the little statues of the characters, which I'm really excited for as well. They're quite costly things, but I'm connected to that franchise more than anything else. It's not like a brand new game idea has just popped up and I'm backing it straight away because, or pre-ordering it straight away because I'm that sort of person. No, it's a well-established game. We've never had a proper version of it in this country, or at least in the Western world. Saiken Densetsu 3, which was its original name, had a fan translation into English originally. And more recently, I think it was last year, we got the collection of Mana given to us in the Western world, which had an actual official English translation, text box to text box, menu to menu, everything of Saiken Densetsu 3. And they changed the name of it to Trials of Mana. Then they announced that this year, I think it's April, it's not April the 10th, is it? I can't remember. Sometime in April, we're getting basically Trials of Mana, but a 3D version of that, a remake of that original game in full, beautiful 3D released to us. And I cannot wait. I've seen more trailers than I care to admit. It's not spoiling anything for me because, obviously I've played the original a lot now, the fan translation, and then the official translation, and then, so on. So it's not like I can spoil anything for myself. But the voice acting is something that I definitely want to point out. It's quite nice to see old games that you played as a kid, right, that were handed down to you, or like the console. The SNES was handed down to me from my brother, and I played the heck out of some 90s RPGs. It was the best thing you could ever be given by a sibling, like the previous generation of console. I don't know if we even have that same experience, if you've had that experience, but it is the best gift your brother or sister or anyone or cousins could ever give you, is their old games and their old consoles or old handheld devices like the Game Boy. Yeah, you have this like weird respect for them when you touch them, or at least I did. I honored the things that came before, and I had more experiences with them than I do with modern games. There's a lot more games out there now. There's a lot more availability for me to play them. You know, I make money, I spend money on games and more YouTube videos and stuff for the videos. But at the end of the day, I have that disposable income. I had hand-me-downs. It made me a better person. I respected that 90s sort of catalog of RPGs and JRPGs that got shipped over. And, you know, we had those little, we had this little cartridge slot thing that you'd put in the cartridge slot of the SNES, the Super Nintendo. And it would let you play American and Japanese games. That was the best thing in the universe. Oh, those things currently are going for like 60 quid or more on eBay because people are still, you know, interested in that past. There's been a retro resurgence. But I have to say, playing some of those games back then when they were relevant, you know, slightly relevant. I mean, I played in like the early 90s. I was born in 1989, so the early 90s was my playground. But at the same time, I was given stuff from like the late 80s or mid 80s. It was fantastic. I miss it more than anything. I know it's rose-tinted, but the games were just, they were not simple in any way. A lot of people confuse old games for being simple or like too hard. No, things weren't too hard and they weren't too simple. It was about thinking. You know, you weren't handheld all the time in everything, especially not the old Final Fantasy RPGs or Secret of Mana, in fact, or the old Zelda games. You had to kind of put two and two together. You had to piece the puzzle yourself, and that was part of the gameplay. You know, you had the Nintendo Power magazines and stuff like that, which actually had really important information in them. You know, you were collecting those magazines, essentially. My brother had a stack of Nintendo Powers, and he, you know, he didn't want to get rid of them simply because of all of the little, you know, they had full-blown maps in them. The games themselves probably didn't have a map function, but they had a full two-page spread map of, like, an area in A Link to the Past. He was blown away by that. Those things are now worth a fortune because of the artistic sort of style that they did them in. And people are trying to replicate that with retro magazines today. But you have to admit that the old games like that do deserve some love. And it does seem to me that Square Enix seem to be the best people for that. There have been some occasions, especially with the mobile ports of Final Fantasy V, for example, and 4, that have come to Steam, which weren't necessarily in their best state and aren't really the best representations of the original game, but a remake of a game they seem to be doing quite well with. I'm really hyped for 7's remake, as you know, if you've watched these videos before. I'm really excited to play that on April 10th. Hopefully it doesn't get delayed anymore. I doubt it will, but I've played the demo to death. Like, I don't know, I think it's up to like 14 playthroughs of that now, something like that, 13, 14, on different modes and trying different things out and staring at walls for too long, or me trying to clip out of bounds and take pictures. It's been a lot of fun to play that demo, and that's just a taster of what's to come. So when it comes to Trials of Mana, I am very much hyped. I would love to see a Chrono Trigger remake. I know that's going to really annoy a few people for me just to say that, because Chrono Trigger is one of those, it is the Secret of Mana. It is the Final Fantasy of its time. It's got its entire fan base. It's a fantastic game. If you've never played Chrono Trigger, please do yourself a favor and try and play the original. The Steam version's not bad, actually. A lot of people have slated that, but they've updated it a little bit. It's good in general. I've enjoyed it. It's a decent port. I have no problems with it personally. The community, however, does have problems because there is a perfectionist attitude that I can completely respect. And it's something that I would probably employ to my favorite game as well, which I did. And there are flaws with Secret of Mana. Don't get me wrong. The remake isn't perfect, but for the most part, it's just a really good game. And it works, and it looks good, it sounds good, and it plays well. And that's what I'm expecting from more Square Enix titles. Chrono Trigger, however, would be just, oh, it would be exceptional. Now, I'm not asking for like a full 3D remake like Final Fantasy VII is getting, because it just wouldn't get the sort of money that's needed to do that, right? What I am asking for, though, is a Secret of Mana or Trials of Mana style version of Chrono Trigger that a new generation can enjoy and people like myself can love, just for being nostalgic. at the end of the day. It is just pure nostalgia. That's not to say I don't want more new RPGs coming out. Stuff like Octopath Traveler, I Am Setsuna, you name it. There's a ton of games that we've played in the past couple of years that honestly have just reignited that spark I had for the traditional RPG, and they are some truly, truly great representations of that genre. It's almost as if, for example, Octopath Traveler, one of my favorite of the new RPGs that have been in existence in the past couple of years, is it's almost as if it was released in the 90s and we just didn't see it. It's that good. It has everything about it that you would want. So yeah, I just want more of that. I know that's really bad to say, but you know, just keep pushing money into these people who want to make more turn-based games. A lot of people were sad about the 7 remake not having a full turn-based system as an option. You know, we have the classic mode, which is essentially like a tactical mode, but it's permanently set to easy on the difficulty selection screen, which is annoying. But it also is basically the same game. It's just easier, and I think you get more time in the selection of abilities, which is kind of eh at the end of the day. I don't really know what they're going for. I love the gameplay so far of 7 Remake, but it feels like they've not answered that question properly. They said, oh, the tactical playthrough of that game is entirely possible. You don't have to play the action stuff, which from what I've played is a complete lie. You could play through it, but you're still going to have to press, you know, that square button to attack repeatedly. You know, I feel that that's a slight problem, but we'll have to wait and see. I'm still going to love the game, right? I still loved it, but that doesn't stop me being overly critical about the way that the game plays in comparison to the one that came before it. I know it's a remake, it's not a remaster, so they can remake everything they want to, including how the game plays, and give it, you know, a fresh lick of paint and change assets to make more sense and stuff like that. I'm looking forward to that, but it's still going to be alongside 7, the original game. It's never going to replace it in my eyes, and I think a lot of people will feel the same. I'm just hoping that they don't omit too much from the remake, considering they're in their episodic nature, which is still a concern. We've talked about that previously. I'm not going to go down that route again, I promise you. But yeah, ultimately, I've really enjoyed this week. Ishgard Restoration's been fun. Final Fantasy XIV is a gift that keeps on giving, especially with rewards. Hopefully you've been enjoying those videos. I see some people a little bit testy with me recently, saying, oh, next thing you'll be doing is a video of every fish in the game, lol. Well, no, it was a housing item. I do housing videos. Please go check that playlist out. This is not something that's brand new. I've been doing this for the longest time. And yeah, sometimes they're filler videos, but I like to show things that I enjoy or have opinions on. The idea of making a video on every fish in a game is just a really weird analogy. I don't understand comments like that. There have also been some people been a little bit irritated with me, the amount of videos I do and stuff like that. The simple answer is not to subscribe and just to not watch them at the end of the day. Or, you know, leave a dislike. If you hate something, press the dislike button. And then if it outweighs the likes in any particular way in the future, then obviously that video idea would be taken away, right? That's how people think. But majoritively, people have been very positive on the videos I have been doing. There's just some, you know, some interesting eggs, not necessarily bad eggs, but interesting eggs, people who really don't think before they speak. And honestly, it would be really nice to critically engage with you guys. I don't want it to be just like, oh, you're doing this wrong, it took me 2 hours and I've got that minion straight away. It's like, well, how did you do it in 2 hours? You know, what were you using? What techniques were you using? You know, what am I doing so wrong that it took me so many days? You know, be critical, explain points, talk to me as if you would a friend, right? That's at the end of the day, that's what we're trying to do. When I see messages like that, which are so vague or so almost passive aggressive, I do scroll past them quite quickly. I don't give them any sort of attention usually, but they do at the same time, you know, slightly irritate me, because there should be so much more that we can engage with there. We can make more content based on that. If I'm doing something wrong, I really like you to tell me constructively, so then I can improve the next time I do it. The fishing video is a prime example of how the comment section worked and didn't work at the same time. People are saying, oh, it's RNG, you don't need to do any of this. It's like, I'm showing you how this worked for me. It worked for me, I have the mount, you clearly do not if you're complaining about it. You know, or if you have the mount, that's fantastic, congratulations. What works for you, works for you. There's no point going on a video and saying, this is lies, this doesn't work, when clearly it does. I showed you the footage. Yes, I edited the stuff together, otherwise it would be a 35-minute long video, you know, that, which is not something I do for my audience. I don't usually push guides out that are 35 minutes. A lot of my audience prefers it when I do a 3 to 5 minute thing, 10 minutes if I have to. I don't push things just to get more money. You know, some YouTubers do things 11 minutes long so they get the extra revenue. I don't do that. I do 3 minute videos now and again. You know, you count how many videos I do that are over 10 minutes in the past month, you'll be surprised. I don't do this for that. I do this, but the byproduct is making some money. But most of it comes from Patreon, right? The people who pay me essentially to keep doing what I'm doing, to keep a roof above my head, and for me to keep eating, you know, to not starve at the end of the day. As long as I've got that, I make my videos. I would make them anyway, but they help my reality exist. Otherwise, I would have to go out and get a job again, and then, you know, you've got the whole never making a video sort of thing again. And I don't want to ever be pushed into that. So yes, money is a thing, but I'm never going to be making that the primary focus. I don't care how big the channel gets, how many subscribers we get, how many viewers. Well, I do care, right? But you know what I mean? I don't care. It's not going to affect the way that I talk to you. It's not going to affect the type of content that I create in a negative way. I'm not going to suddenly start doing everything at 10 minutes long. You know, this specific video today, this tea time videos and other tea time videos are not there primarily to make money. Yes, they do make some money, but it's not the main focus of them. It's to talk to you. I can't live stream. If I could live stream, I would be doing that daily. It would be part of my routine. I'd have a schedule. I don't have access to that. So here I am doing what I do. This is what I do. This is what I enjoy. I enjoy talking about the games, but I love and sharing my passion. And that's why in the description of my channel, it says, this is my little hobby. I hope you enjoy the videos I make, because that's what it started as. And that's what it still is. I don't see the point in changing that. Yes, I get to cover some incredible games and, you know, hopefully I can go to FanFest if it's not called off in London next year. But that doesn't change the fact that it's still stuff I want to do. You know, I love talking for hours with random people. We have a public Discord, of which there is a link to in the description. I love engaging with people, having critical arguments and discussions, you know, engaging with people, seeing what makes them so passionate about their area of the game or the games they enjoy and what they dislike and why, and, you know, stuff like that. That's why I do YouTube. Not necessarily to, you know, pick fault with people or make money, but I want to just share that experience. So it lessens things a little bit when I see some of the comments like that. So if you are going to be, you know, respond critically to a point, then I would value that more than anything, rather than just either providing me an insult or a slur, which gets, you know, automatically pulled in by the filter I've set up. I had to sit there and type in literally every word I can think of that I would find detestable. That includes things like the N-word and, you know, I had to physically type those in to a filter to actually prevent the comment sections of videos being filled with language like that, which is why for the most part you don't see any of those negative comments. However, they still come into my inbox in that separate folder, and sometimes I go in there and I check through them. Obviously links are disallowed and stuff like that, and it auto-generates blockages for those people, but for the most part I'm just trying to keep things tidy. So I would rather you act constructively and talk to me like a person in the comment section. Otherwise, there's a very real likelihood of it getting, you know, taken into a separate folder where most of us will never get to see it. So you're just talking or shouting verbally, abusively at a wall at the end of the day, whereas you could be engaging with the content creator or influencer or whatever you want to call me at the end of the day, and we'll actually get some really cool sort of feedback from that. Anyway, that's my little bit of a rant. I've taken up 45 or so minutes of your time today. Hopefully that's helped you kill some time. I know a lot of you are still going through some terrible things in real life. I'll give the same advice as I did last time. Keep clean where you can. You know, stay in if you possibly can, work from home. All of the stuff that the government's telling you in your, you know, area, wherever you live. Some people in the world have, you know, better lockdowns than others. In the UK, currently, we're not fully locked down, and you're free to walk into town and do whatever you want, which is obviously something that I've got my own opinions on, especially when it comes to our government currently, but I'm not going to get political. I just want you to be safe as much as possible. Drink plenty of water. If you do have coronavirus, which I do believe some of you have, just try and keep yourself as healthy as possible. Drink, make sure you eat properly. That's one of the things people forget. Exercise if you fancy it, but obviously a lot of you might not feel like that. And play some good games. There's some really, really good games coming out. There's obviously lots of free stuff on the internet as well, such as YouTube. And enjoy yourself. So hopefully you have a good weekend, or at least a comfortable weekend wherever you are. Enjoy the rest of your day, and I'll see you all next time.